Hello, gamers, and thank you for tuning into another episode of the Cartridge Club. If you're new to the Cartridge Club, I'll quickly explain who we are. The Cartridge Club is a community of gamers, collectors, content creators, and gaming enthusiasts of all generations. The show that you're listening to is effectively a monthly book club, but for gamers. We pick a game, invite everyone in the club to play along, and select a couple of members of the community to come on the show to discuss the game. My name is Ryan, other known as ItsRocketSauce, and I'm one of the hosts for the show. Without further ado, let me introduce the panel for this month. Today we have two wonderful guests, and they are Pam.
Hello.
And Kevin, other known as Buried on Mars.
Hey now.
And now I'm going to hand it off to my co-host MustyHobbit, and he'll let us know what game we are playing for this month. Take it away, Musty.
Thank you, Ryan, and thank you all for being here. Today we are kicking off Season 6 of the Cartridge Club Prime podcast. As you may recognize here, Ryan and I have taken over as new hosts of the show, and so we are excited to bring you a slightly adjusted edition of the show. Same general concept is there, but we're kind of taking a few different approaches to things, the first of which being that we are now broadcasting the show live to our club backers through Patreon. So for those of you who are watching live, thank you for joining us. And if you are interested in being a part of the live broadcast, you can definitely check out our Patreon for that. But the game we are playing, one of the more frantic shooters of the last couple years and kind of a genre-redefining game. We are playing 2016's id Software classic Doom. And to give you a little bit of background on the game, we are going to kick off to a new segment that we are calling The Breakdown.
Reboot of the long-running id Software franchise, Doom is set in the UAC research facility on the surface of Mars. You play as a silent marine, affectionately referred to as the Doomslayer, who wakes to find himself chained to an altar in what seems to be some cultish ceremony. Barely escaping his chains before being attacked by some sort of disfigured skeletal humanoid, the Doomslayer dons his trademark Praetor armor, throws what little exposition there is against the wall, and sets out to restore signal to a satellite dish and figure out why the facility is being run rampant with Hellspawn. Through audio logs and holographs, we discovered that the purpose of this facility is to solve the human energy crisis back on Earth, and in doing so has opened a portal to Hell to draw infinitely sustainable Argent energy from that dimension. In addition, Samuel Hayden, director of the facility, has been conducting multiple expeditions and has brought back samples of these demons, keeping them confined for study and potential weaponization. So why has the facility gone to Hell? One of the scientists, Olivia Pierce, made a pact with an unseen demon lord and released the confined demons on the base, along with providing the demon lord with all the cybernetic enhancements they could ever want. It's this event that motivated Hayden to release you with the goal of repelling the invasion and restoring order to the facility. Olivia then takes it one step further by blowing open the portal between dimensions, unleashing Hell on Mars. As the Doomslayer, you take multiple trips to Hell and back, riding through expansive combat environments, tight corridors, waves of demons, and some monstrous bosses. And as you navigate, the level's progression will at times require you to collect red, yellow, or blue key cards to unlock new areas of the map, eventually finding an exit to the level. Along the way, there are secrets galore, special power-ups, weapon upgrades, perk unlocking rune trials, and hidden areas, some even in the style of the original game. Along the way, your arsenal grows, from pistols to shotguns, Gatling guns, and plasma rifles, rocket launchers, a chainsaw, and the BFG 9000. The implements of demon destruction are numerous. While you still have ammo to keep count of, there is never any reloading, so you won't have to worry about if you fired 6 shots or only 5. In addition to those weapons, the Doomslayer is capable of executing staggered enemies with brutal glory kills, which both aid in providing a momentary slowing in the gameplay, along with some of the most gruesome visuals. These glory kills also provide much-needed health pickups, so the reward for pulling them off is necessary if you want to survive the level. And this is where the pacing and flow of Doom comes into play, and what really sets it apart from other first-person shooters of any generation. Running low on health? Execute imps with glory kills, ammo inventory almost out, break out the chainsaw, and the ammo drops explode from the severed corpses of Hell Knights, Revenants, and Barons of Hell. Shifting from weapon to weapon and always moving forward are a must. There is no cover here, so you'll need to stay mobile to prevent being overrun. On top of the 13-level campaign, Doom boasts a robust online multiplayer suite and snap map creator, and one of the most adrenaline-pumping soundtracks of all time. Doom is the perfect package for fans of the original franchise and anyone who loves the first-person shooter genre. But that's enough for me. Let's get into our panel's first impressions and experience with the game.
So originally I saw Doom at an E3, I believe. It was 2014 or 2015, and it wasn't something that really appealed to me. It looked kind of, you know, just a generic kind of shooter. I sort of forgot about it not long after seeing it. But then Will picked it up not long after it came out. And as soon as I got my hands in on it, like, my perspective on the game just changed completely. It was like, oh my God, this is so frantic and fun. And I immediately just sort of blazed through the game immediately. And since then, I've played it another two times. So it was one of those things where initially not impressed by the marketing, and then as soon as I got my hands on the game, it was just sort of like, wow, this is what a shooter should be.
So for me, I actually, this was a game that I, a rare game that I actually got excited for before it came out. I had played Wolfenstein Reboot, and Bethesda did such an excellent job with that game. I was looking forward to the re-downloaded the demo, the multiplayer demo for the game, and I wasn't impressed. It wasn't, it didn't feel like anything that I would be interested in playing. So I actually put the game on the back burner. I canceled my pre-order, and I waited until, I believe it was either Black Friday or Boxing Day sale, or it might have been Amazon Prime Day. I can't remember which, but they had the game, the special edition version of the game with the statue that came with it for the regular price of a regular game. It was like $80. So I said, you know what, I'll get that, and then I'll have a statue that, and if I don't like the game, I can get rid of the statue, or I can keep the statue and pretend that it's from one of the original games. So I started playing it, and I was like, yeah, this is Doom. This is the way it's meant to be. This is good stuff. And like Pam, I breezed through it in probably a couple of sittings, and good game.
I had forgotten that Wolfenstein had come out first, because I had been really impressed by Wolfenstein, but I don't know, I didn't like register in my mind that, oh, they probably did a good job with Doom as well.
Yeah.
It's funny that, Kevin, that you mentioned that multiplayer, because I completely forgot about that they gave away that demo for the multiplayer to play, because I remember, I don't know if it was an E3 trailer, but I remember seeing it, and then they announced that they're doing that free beta of the multiplayer, and I jumped on it. So that was probably my first experience with this game. And very much like you, Kevin, I wasn't too impressed with it. Not the gameplay, because the gameplay was actually pretty damn good in it. It's just that I guess I wasn't having fun in the battle arenas for it. It was something still in my interest, because I've heard, you know, I saw the reviews, I saw the story, you know, it had a story. So it kind of made, you know, I like a story driven first person shooter. And then I remember seeing it on Conan O'Brien's Clueless Gamer. And I think that was kind of like the pushing for me where I really wanted to get it. Cause I forgot what celebrities he had on it. It could have been a couple of football players, but it looked, from the gameplay, it looked a lot more fun from seeing it, you know, him rip through the monsters and everything. And I believe I knew I think I might have been a little skeptical of it, where I didn't want to pay $60 for it. But within a couple of months, it was on sale at GameStop for like $20. So I jumped on in there. And then I went from there, I played it. It was fantastic. And from that point forward, like, if I found out someone was playing Doom, I kind of was like saying, hey, what'd you thought of, you know, think of it? Because it was pretty damn good for me. I wasn't too familiar with the game's history. I played it on the 64 for like kind of like a first time with the original game, if you will, even though that's not the original game. I remember seeing the original game back in the day on I guess the school computers that people would bring it in and play it in the computer lobby, but there was something I couldn't get into because I could never get the keyboard mouse format down for the game. So I kind of always wanted to get into the franchise, but I felt this was a good, I guess, launching point for myself. So
yeah, that's good. I think I had a similar kind of path to I think both Pam and Kevin, my first exposure to the game was I think when they announced it at E3, and I think they announced it at E3, and they Bethesda did, you know, their little presentation. I was just like, okay, that I was lukewarm on it at that point. The beta, the multiplayer beta came out. I think I downloaded it, but I never actually went into the game. And then I rented it on day one when it came out, and I played the first two levels or so, maybe. It may have only been the first level, and I just wasn't feeling it. I don't know if I wasn't in the right mind space for it at the time. I don't know what else was going on, but I just wasn't, despite how visually stimulating this game is, I wasn't feeling it at the time. Cut to 6 to 7 months later at the Game Awards. Mick Gordon does a set as after winning, I think they got sound design and music awards from that show. And the set they did brought me right back in. I was just like, because they were playing music that I hadn't heard, because they were playing stuff from, you know, the middle portion of the game. And I was just like, hold on a second, let's give this another try. And I think like 2 weeks later, I went and picked it up and just plowed through it, and it was I regret not having persevered at the start, but I think I understand I just wasn't in the right headspace for it. But not my first exposure to Doom, though. I had the old shareware version. I don't know if you guys ever play the original 93. Brian, you said they used to bring it into school, right?
Correct. Yeah, that was in the computer lobby. That I'm not sure. I think every machine actually might have had it installed at some point in time too, because the computer lab guy was pretty relaxed, and he was a younger guy and he wasn't really a teacher, so he was just in charge of making sure no one's stealing the computers. So people were either doing homework on the machines, or either playing like Doom or maybe even Duke Nukem or something on those machines.
Nice.
School appropriate.
Of course.
They didn't go in that computer room, I guess, the teacher. So.
Yeah, I played pretty much a huge chunk of the 90s was me spending time playing Doom and Doom 2 and Final Doom. I loved all those games back then, but I probably put more hours into the shareware version of Doom than all the other three combined, because, you know, that's all I had. Buying video games wasn't in my dad's wheelhouse, if I could say, and he was more into getting the free stuff, and that was the free one that was floating around. And yeah, I played through that thing so many times, found every little secret. I remember it was one of the games where you went to school and people would say, did you get the chainsaw? And you're like, there's a chainsaw. And so then you have to go and find the chainsaw. And that was a very cool moment. But yeah, so Doom was a big part of my growing up in the 90s.
It probably cemented the PC-ness even more for you, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So we did a poll. We've been putting some polls out on Twitter lately. And one of the questions we asked to the community was if this was Doom 2016 was their first experience with the Doom franchise. And an overwhelming majority said hell no, with 86% of them having experienced Doom in some form prior, and 14% a hell yes. And so nice to at least give some people some new exposure to this franchise. Obviously it's been around for forever, 25 years at this point. But it had been kind of dormant after Doom 3 on the Xbox, and which isn't, I guess, by all accounts a true Doom game. Leaned more on that survival horror. But this game, I mean, this game has its own share of, scariness and intimidation and things like that. What did you guys, Ryan, I want to ask you first, you know, what did you think of how this game, like the ambiance, the environments and things in this game? What do you think on this?
It's very, I don't know if scary, but it's very... I don't want to say testosterone driven, because it's, you know, intense. Very, you know,
menacing. I was going to go with menacing,
but yeah. The thing about it is I think it's funny if I'm thinking about Doom Guy, right? That's his name, right? It's Doom Guy, or the Hellwalker, if they want to call him that. He's very, it's a very dude bro character, but I think it's kind of funny with the, I guess just, you know, wherever he's getting orders from somebody and just rips apart the device or something. But no, it's very much plays into with the monsters too. Like if you shoot them and you weaken them, you know, they'll turn blue and you can just rip them apart. So, and I don't know, it's, I didn't find it spooky so much, but I found it kind of comically overboard, and I thought it was fantastic. I liked it for that reason.
There's a certain level of appropriateness when I mean, it's strange to call it appropriate, but in the whole like mythos of this game and this franchise, it works. Strangely, it works extremely well.
I think part of what keeps you on your toes in this game is that in a lot of shooters now, the enemies kind of stay on the other side of the room that you're in, and you find cover, and you're playing like a almost like a duck hunt game with them. You know, they're popping out of the cover and you're trying to hit them before they can get you. One thing that this game does well, which is a great throwback to the old first person shooters, is that the enemies will flank you and they will encroach on your space. They come right up to you. They keep coming closer and closer, and you have to move quickly in order to keep them. Like, you can't stop. You can't stop in one spot and start shooting at them because you will get annihilated. This is a projectile shooter. You know, you got to move out of the way from their shots, and you got to keep moving. And as the space keeps closing and closing in on you, I get that claustrophobic feel as they come and encroach in on you. And I think that's more of the horror part of Doom that has been there since, you know, the first game. And that is the part that's transcended. And that's the part that was missing in Doom 3. They tried to take elements from what was working in horror games at that time and implement it into a Doom game. And I think that's part of the reason why Doom 3 didn't work and why this game does work, is that they went back to those roots and went back to those scary parts of those games.
Yeah, I mean, there were moments in the original Doom where like a door would open up behind you and you had no idea, and suddenly you were flooded with guys. I think they, like you said, they kind of do the same thing without having too many of those. I mean, they just spawn in out of nowhere. Suddenly there's a new like wave of enemies. But yeah, I totally get what you're saying.
Yeah, I don't think that was a mechanic that they could do on the original Doom. Like, those sprites were all there, you know, in the original game. They just would hide them behind walls so you wouldn't be able to find them. And this one, yeah, they just spawn in. Yeah, you get into a lot of areas where you have to, it's almost like a death match in a way. You'll get into an area and you have to wipe out all the guys in that area before you can move on, before you can advance. And yeah, that, you know, that was a huge part of the original game too. And it's good to see that is back in this game.
Yeah. So the gore nests, I think, are the one of the additions here. Yeah, that's kind of you can peruse the room, figure things out, and then the moment that you do that, things get crazy. Things get really crazy. Yep. Music ramps up. All of a sudden, you've got, you know, anywhere from 10 to 20 enemies in the room of varying difficulty. Let's talk a little bit about the enemies, because those that can kind of lead us into some other discussion points. There was a lot of careful attention paid to honoring the original game in the way that a lot of the enemies look. You know, right out the gate, aside from the, I guess there are those sort of shotgun wielding or like assault rifle wielding humanoids, like humans that have been kind of, I don't even know what to, possessed.
They're zombies. So
they're the possessed, zombies. Right? Yeah. But then you get into the imps and those scream of the original game. What do you guys have a favorite? Like, is there one enemy type that you either loved or hated, or that you you always knew what to, you know, like, you, all of these had kind of a rock, paper, scissors element to them in some manner as well. So did you have ones that you like, you love going up against because you could always take them out really, really easily? Or I don't know. Pam, I want to get your thoughts on some enemies here.
Sure. There were a few that I really liked. Like, I liked the, no, I am not going to remember every enemy name, but the flying guys, I think they're the Caco demons. And they would just like explode once you got them. I liked those. I liked the more stationary ones. I really liked the Baron of Hell just because he looked really awesome. The ones that I didn't like were the ones that tended to go away. There was one sort of like tall, willowy enemy that would just port around the room. Those I always found annoying because I'd get my like rocket missiles like locked on and then they would just go off to the other side of the room. One thing I just wanted to say though about the enemies was that I like that when sort of larger ones are introduced, it's almost like a little boss introduction for them. I mean, you don't actually see any bosses until probably the second half of the game, but like the first time you see a Mancubus, the first time you see a Baron of Hell, it's like it's a boss, mm-hmm. but then it just becomes one of the standard enemy that you're going to come up against at any time in the game.
In multiples too, right?
Like, in multiples, yeah.
Yeah, like that. There's one encounter where there's like at least three Barons of Hell, which is, mm-hmm. yeah, that part is,
yeah, like
crazy.
Like the first time I saw a Mancubus, I thought it was a boss, and that's like where I really got my head wrapped around the whole strafing aspect of the game because he had very obvious fireballs that he was firing at you, and that's where I really got like, okay, this is like a never stop moving kind of thing. And it took so long to kill him that first time. And then, you know, by the end, there's just multiples and they're cyber mancubuses. And
yeah. So Ryan, I remember watching some of your Twitch streams and you seemed to deal with mancubuses pretty easily. What was your kind of go-to bread and butter for taking those guys out?
So I don't remember the name of the gun, but it's the one that shares the, is it a plasma cannon maybe? Or the one that's not the rifle, the plasma rifle, but it shares the same ammunition.
The Gauss
cannon, yeah.
Yeah, I found that thing could rip those suckers apart, especially if you could just, you kind of want to aim for, I guess its belly that would hang underneath its armor. And usually within two shots, it usually, if you can charge it up too, I believe that is an upgrade that might come with that gun.
There's the zoom on it. Yeah.
Yeah. That usually takes that apart pretty quickly. As for, I guess least favorite, I'm trying to remember the, I'm combing it through, but I think Pam is the one you mentioned that moves around the room so quickly.
Mm-hmm. Is that the summoner?
Yeah. The summoner is the worst. I absolutely hate that one. I generally try to save my chainsaw if I know that there's at least one or two in that room, because I'll let it try to get to its area and spawn, because shooting at it just takes off, and absolutely hate those things. Seeing if there's anyone's Hell Knights are fun, I guess, because, you know, I don't know if they're fun, but I have a thing for every one of those guys. That's the thing. And it's like you're saying, Musty, about the rock, paper, scissors. I kind of know I have weapons that I try to save ammo for each room for a guy, for each fight. You're going to die a lot in this game is all I'm going to say. So once you find out the lay of the room, I find that I know what my line of attack is going to be and kind of what order I want to do it. If that makes any sense, but
it
yeah,
does.
It's,
yeah, it does. Yeah. Cause I mean, you know that if you, I don't know, if you don't get the imps, then eventually you'll have eight of them on you while you're trying to deal with something much bigger. And those, their fireballs came more out of nowhere for me than the others. Like all of a sudden I would just be down, and it's just because, you know, two of them hit me right in the back with fireballs. But
that's why I gotta keep moving, Musty.
This
can't stay in one spot.
This is true. Just keep swimming. Sorry, Ryan. I cut off your line of thought there.
No, it's just it's stuff like if I see like a pinky, I guess, you know, charging at me, you kind of want to just let it come at you like a bull, and then just if you can strafe to the side and then hit it back, pull out the Gatling gun that I found, which I completely forgot on this playthrough that I actually had, and then pull it back out until probably the later levels, because I was running out of ammo on a lot of my weapons going against these things, and I found out I had that, and that that ripped that thing, the pinkies apart. So it's one of those things where, I don't know, you get comfortable using some of the same weapons over and over again. Once you find out that there's a better weapon for trial and error, if you will, you know, find out what's a better weapon going against another, you know, another enemy, you kind of try to play out the game a little bit differently, if you will.
Kevin, did you have a favorite weapon among the mix?
I don't know if I had a favorite weapon, but what I did like, what Ryan was kind of alluding to, is that how you had to keep using different weapons. I found myself switching between the weapons, using like the shotgun, the super shotgun was pretty much like your go-to one when you got in a real jam and you couldn't figure it out. And that one would generally get you out of any mess. But yeah, there were better weapons for each different type of enemy. And that's what I liked. I liked that I was constantly switching weapons to use something different, because I do find that a lot of shooters kind of have that one overpowered weapon that you could just stick to throughout the entire game. And not, and it's like, well, what's the point of all these other weapons if you're not forced to use them? I just wanted to mention too about the enemies. I liked how there was a little bit of a twist on the classic enemies, like the imps. You know, they were pretty straightforward in the original game. They would run at you and they would throw their projectiles straight at you and you would avoid them. And in this game, they would hang onto the walls. They would jump off to the side. Their projectiles would arc towards you. So if you, there is a possibility that if you weren't looking at them when they throw it at you and you turn at them, that it's coming at you and you won't even see it. I liked all those little twists, even the pink demon too, having to hit it from behind. In the original game, they would just come running right at you and you would just shoot at them. So that, it was interesting that they would put all these little twists on these classic characters and gave them, I don't know, it was impressive that it actually worked. You know, normally like, oh, they changed this, I don't like this, but this, it seemed to, all the little changes they made worked in this game. So that was impressive.
Yeah. Were the Gorness in the original game by chance?
No. The keys were, like, it was a lot of, you know, finding the keys or hitting the buttons. But no, there was nothing like that I can remember anyways, like a Gorness.
Those things I always dreaded when you see it. And there's, I want to say there's one level in particular, I think, that has just, you have to take out four of them. And
is that the foundry, the one that's all lava looking?
Yeah, that one's like, I guess if you want to talk about that horror element, that's kind of one of those ones where you see it, you know, there's smaller guys could just all around it, but nothing really fun happens until you rip it apart, basically. But that's one of those ones, as soon as you rip it apart, you got to just go, just keep moving. Mm-hmm.
There's a strange kind of dance to transitioning between weapons and the constant moving, and you have to do all this stuff simultaneously. Otherwise, it's like Kevin, like you reiterated, you stop, you die. Like, that's just... It's just how it works. But yeah, you kind of, I found myself in sections where I was not surviving through, you know, that gore nest or something like that. Like, I was like putting a mental like checklist as far as, yeah, like, okay, I'm going to take out, you know, the imps with, I'm going to use this and I'm going to take out all the imps. And then, yeah, and then you go to the next one and then you switch to this and it's like, okay, well, now I'm out of ammo. So now it's time to break out the chainsaw. And I'm going to use that on this guy. And I always reserved the chainsaw for Barons of Hell. When by that point in the game, I was saving it for them. So I would usually almost exhaust, and then find one of those guys and take him out. That's probably not the best move. I probably should have been eliminating them earlier. But
yeah, I used my chainsaw on the Barons of Hell a lot too. They gave you so much ammo and they could be such a hassle that's where I would use them, although I would tend to use it at the beginning of a fight rather than at the end. There was just one other anime I wanted to mention that I actually feel kind of detracts from the game, and that's the guys with the shields. Like the summoners I found annoying how they would run away from me, but I felt like the shield guys sort of actively slowed things down. It kind of like killed my bloodlust buzz having to go after them or like get around behind them, and those were the one enemy that I actually thought were like not a great enemy as opposed to just not enjoyable to fight.
Yeah, I found myself having to throw grenades at their feet and hope that it staggered them. which did not always work. Mm. And then he got a kind of, they turned too quickly.
The grenades are very underpowered in this game. If there's one weak thing, like it's like you would throw it and it felt like it would, they would just like, out of all the action that's going on, all the explosions and you're tearing demons apart, you throw these grenades and they would just like pop instead of boom, you know? I wanted to mention the chainsaw too. I liked how they, the enemies, when you would kill the enemies with the chainsaw, that it, they would dump ammo, which doesn't make any sense, but in a video game world, that makes sense. And it makes sense to have it dump ammo because you would normally go to the chainsaw when you were down on ammo, right? You're running low on ammo. So I just thought that was a nice mechanic, and that it wasn't, there was a certain limit to it. Like, it was very limited. You had to find those gas containers in order to keep that thing running. So you couldn't go to it all the time. You had to make sure you had enough gas there in case you were low on ammo. I liked all that part to the game.
I think that's one of the things that works the best for me of the whole game, is that when you're low on ammo, when you're low on health, the solution isn't to go hide. It's to like get ultra aggressive, like get in there, do a glory kill, whip out your chainsaw. So it's like sort of the opposite of what you would do in any other shooter.
Yeah, you have to use those glory kills to survive. There's no way you can get through it without it. You could probably only use the shotgun. You could probably get away with never upgrading any of the weapons, but I don't think you could play through the game without doing those glory kills.
So it saves ammo. I mean, it saves ammo and gives you a little bit and the health boost. Yeah, for sure.
Gives you an enemy to focus on too, because there's so many enemies. And then once you see that glowing one there, it's like, okay, I got to go get that guy first, get him out of the way.
It's a good breather. It's like a fraction of a second just to collect, because usually you're in the middle of a pile of them, right? And there's the one that you like zip to. I know there was an upgrade from one of the rune trials that allowed you to glory kill from a further distance, so they would turn orange, but you could be further away, and it would just like, I don't know, I'm gonna say teleport, but it zips you right there, and suddenly you're in the middle of that. There were some other ones that would do things like, after a glory kill, you move like a certain percentage faster. And did you guys come across rune trials at all? Like, or did you do them if you did come across them?
I did, and I skipped them.
I did all of them.
I did a few. I plan on doing all of them. I should mention that this playthrough, like I played through the game before, and this playthrough I've been going through and finding all the secrets and that, but I'm trying not to use any guide or anything like that. I just use what the map gives me, so it takes forever. And sometimes you get to the end of the level and you realize you've missed one, so you got to go back and play it all again, which is surprisingly easy with all, once you have your character all upgrade, I'm playing it on one of the more difficult settings, and it's still not that difficult to do.
Were you playing on PC?
Yeah, so did you guys all play on consoles?
Using controllers?
I did.
Yeah, I did. My first time I played, it was on PS4, and then I played on Xbox this time.
I didn't even know this was happening until I was watching one of Ryan's streams. But when you have the controller, you can hit a button, and it brings up that wheel.
Yeah, I believe it's L1.
Select a different...
I believe if you hold down L1, it brings it up on the PS4.
Yeah, see, that's a whole, like, that's like a newer, like a modern first-person that is so, I just thought it was so cool that I played through the entire game that first time, and I didn't even know that existed, because I was playing on PC, and I was just using 1 through 8 to select all my different weapons. And I actually, like maybe a day or two before I watched your stream, Ryan, I actually went back and tried to play the game with a controller. And I wrote down in my notes that this game is way harder with a controller. It's so much easier with the mouse and keyboard, because I didn't know that feature was there. I didn't even look to see. But then once you have that wheel there, that changes the whole game, because it slows down the game to a crawl, and it gives you time to decide which other weapon you can use. And yeah, that's like, I don't know. I just thought that was cool that they put that all in there for people that are using a controller. But if you don't want it, you don't have to use it. You can just completely ignore it. So it's kind of neat that they made both PC gamers and console gamers happy.
Does the PC version have the wheel as an option? Like, you can hit a button?
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
Yeah, even on the mouse and keyboard, if you hold down Q, it pops it up. So you can play that way if you want to, but I just never thought of it. You know,
because
I didn't even look
at it. It is great because it lets you recoup, you know, and you'll see the hordes coming at you. You'll see like, okay, what's my line of attack? You can take a breath for a second. It slows down everything and then select the appropriate weapon.
Yeah. And,
no, it's great for that reason. No, it's fantastic for that because with all the stress coming at you, it's just nice to have that breather for that moment, if you will.
I've just seen that mechanic in other games, and you cannot play the game without using that. Like, I think I can't remember what the first game was, but a lot of first-person shooters, newer ones, have that in there. And you could, like, a lot of PC gamers complain about something like that, you know. And it was just cool that it was in this game, and you didn't even have to use it, you know.
I think how it is too for the controller version is that there isn't, you know, you can't just rotate between all the weapons. I believe you can only go back to the previous weapon. So besides having your BFG and your chainsaw as an option on the controller, I think you can only go back to your previous one unless you hold down the wheel. So, but I think it's nice for that feature alone, though.
On the PC, you can map the different buttons. I was looking at it after, and you can map, like, if you had like the shotgun, say that was your favorite, and you can map it to the Y button, so like it would go automatically to that if you wanted to. I don't know if that's on the PC or the console versions.
No, they didn't have a favorites list. I like that the super weapons have their own face buttons, like that. That was really nice that I didn't even have to think, like, it was, you know, if I'm gonna break out the BFG, boom, it was done. It was there. I didn't have to slow things down. I could just easily toggle to it. And the same with the chainsaw. One thing I was going to bring up about the chainsaw really quickly was there, it had a certain amount of gas units, and the enemy that you take down kind of varied how many gas units it exhausted. So like the bigger guys would take like four. So you couldn't, you say you couldn't spam it. It has a limited amount, but it even has a more, you need to be careful about who you're using that on. Cause if you waste it on too many little guys, then all of a sudden you don't have enough, to take out the Baron of Hell or a Pinky or something like that. So again, Ryan was PS4, Pam, you played on both consoles. I also played on the Xbox One. Now our community, a lot of them, 37% of them, played on Switch. Unfortunately, we don't have anyone representing that group here today. Because any of you played the Switch version? No.
I haven't played it myself, but Will played it on Switch recently, and I watched some of that. It definitely does not look as good on handheld mode. He didn't really play it on docked mode too much, but
okay.
I'm not super, you know, snobby about my graphics, but I'm sometimes snobby about the Switch. So,
well, there's a performance level too that you kind of have to think about, right? I mean, like it's like a lock 30, but it's not 60.
Yeah, I'm snobby about my graphics and the Switch, and I don't know how anyone can play this game in 30 frames per second. I'll just go on record saying that.
I just don't see how anyone could play it with the, like, the Joy-Cons.
Little knobs,
That's where I get stuck, yeah.
You'd be using that L1 button a lot to slow things down. Mm-hmm. You'd have to.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, but so the breakdown was 26% PC, 15% PS4, 22% Xbox One, and 37% Nintendo Switch. So thank you to those who voted in that poll. Fun to interject those things. I want to go through weapons one last time. I'm curious. Well, we had one last poll, and then we'll move away from these, where we took the eight major weapons minus the BFG, because who doesn't love a BFG, and put them up tournament style against each other. So the first poll was, pick your favorite between, or which one do you enjoy using the most between chainsaw, super shotgun, plasma rifle, and rocket launcher? And the next one was pistol, vortex rifle, Gauss cannon, and chain gun. And the first poll, Super Shotgun, overwhelming winner, 54% took the Super Shotgun. And then on the second poll, it was the Gauss Cannon, went 48%. Put those two head-to-head, and we had a overwhelming win for Super Shotgun, who took 75% of the vote between that and the Gauss Cannon. So, Kevin, like you were saying, the Super Shotgun's kind of the multi-purpose. It works well about against just about everything, but it I found myself not using it.
Same. Really?
I found, yeah.
I forgot about it, to be honest with you. And I found the other, sorry, Musty, I don't mean to interrupt.
No, go for it.
I
think I know what you're going to say, but.
Well, I think the other shotgun, I think, was more efficient. So that's why I stuck more with that, to be honest with you. And I completely forgot it. I didn't like the add-ons that came with the Super Shotgun, too.
There were none.
There was I thought like an acid, like, addition to the ammo, I thought. Like, it made the ammo stronger.
Oh, maybe you're right.
To me, for how I had people mapped out, it took up more ammo than the regular shotgun. And yeah. I found I could use stuff like with the regular shotgun, I could use like, it had like a grenade launcher attachment to it too, as opposed to using, I don't know. It seemed like the other shotgun was more efficient for me.
I don't know. Anytime I got in a jam, I just whipped that thing out and it was like, I was out of that jam.
Yeah, I didn't use it much either just because I found it slowed things down. I like having lots of ammo. Yeah. It felt a little bit slow to me.
You didn't have to aim with it either. Like, you just could point it in a general direction. So maybe that might have been part of it. I don't know.
Could be. And maybe I'm not giving it a fair shake because I was finding those ones that were strong, whereas I probably could have just continued to run with that Super Shotgun instead. I'll have to give it another try.
I want to say I really did like the pistol, since we're still talking about the weapons. I always entered every room with the pistol, and for the fact that I want to say, what were the name of the guys that hang on the walls again?
Imps.
So I found that, like, if you can charge the pistol, you can take them out with one shot. You know, they'll kill them instantly. Same thing with the some of the bigger guys. Like, if you can, like, headshot them with the pistol, it'll take them out right away. And then when stuff would start getting more intense is when I would switch it to a shotgun or the plasma rifle or assault rifle. And I also kind of forgot about the BFG, to be honest with you. But then when I remembered, I would always save it for towards the end of the room. It almost was kind of game breaking, if you will, but in a good way, where it's, I remember, I think I was struggling in that room. It's before you take like an elevator, like the elevator is like the end of the level. And it ends you with three of the big guys in that room. Messing up all their names here. But essentially, like, was it
Mancubus? The big,
no, not the Mancubus, is the Guardians of Hell, whatever they're called.
The Barons.
Yeah. The Barons of Hell. There you go.
Oh, wait, no. No, hold on. Are you talking about the one boss battle with the guy with the shield and the would spin with the fire?
No.
Those were Guardians.
I'm thinking of the level I'm thinking of is the one where it's got like three floors, basically, and it's just hundreds of enemies coming at you. And I believe the last three is the Barons of Hell. Like, it's like that's the last three, the spawner. And they're all coming at you, but if you just pull out the BFG, it takes out all three of them instantly. Mm-hmm. And then you just get in the elevator. Because I remember I died a whole bunch of times because I was almost always out of ammo at that point in time, or at least the chainsaw, or if I was out of like shotgun or rockets at that point. And I think I pulled out accidentally. I think I bumped the wrong button. And all of a sudden I'm like, oh yeah, I have this. And I just, you know, instantly took them out. And I was like, well, I just spent, you know, I died four times here trying to figure out this last little part. And, you know, instantly it was like oh, that was nothing, just get right in the elevator and the level's over with.
Yeah, so we've talked a lot about the methods of demon destruction. We haven't really talked about the story at all, and I think this game gets kind of an unfair rap with regards to people just saying, oh, it's just, you know, it's your bro shooter, you know, that kind of thing. And there is a story to it. It is a little bit deeper than people make it out to be. And so wanted to get your guys' thoughts on the story. Maybe Kevin, we'll have you go first, since you have experience with the other games all the way back to the beginning. Like, what do you think of how they portrayed this story? Did you like it?
I see this tradition is continuing, where you come to me first about the story, because I have no clue as to what was going on with the story. At the beginning of the game, the guy smashes the screen when the guy's talking to him, and he says, "I don't care about the story. I just want to play this game." That was me. I have no idea what's going on. There's some old lady that is opening up gates of hell on Mars, and you got to go fight everybody. At the end of the game, you fight a cyber demon and a mastermind. That's it. That's all I need to know. So I had no idea what was going on. At one point, you're on Mars. Next point, you're in hell. I don't know. Was there anything more to it?
And then back. And then back. Hell, between hell and Mars. I'm kind of with you on this one, Kevin. And I'm not poo-pooing the story. It's just that maybe it's just my impression of just going through the game. With all the action going on, I'm trying to focus on what I'm going to do, and the story just goes way over my head. You know, just completely miss it, and I'm just killing bad guys. You know, it's kind of what it is. You know, it's like you're saying, you go to hell, you go, you know, go back to Mars. It's one of those things that just went over my head, and I've played this twice now. I've beaten it twice now. It's just over my head. I know what's going on. There's an artifact that's opening the portal to hell, and they're going to use it for energy, but it just goes over my head. You know, it's not a bad thing, I guess. It's, you know, because I guess it's not the bread and butter of the game.
Yeah, I didn't find it. Sure, like,
That's fair. I'll give you that. It's not. I think other Bethesda games in recently have done better in the story department than this one. I just think there's more to it than I think it's easy to gloss over it, maybe because those low moments are moments to recover. And so you're not focusing on what's being said, potentially.
Yeah, I'm not saying that it's a bad story. It's probably great. And it just wasn't the carrot that I needed to keep playing this game.
Sure.
And I just didn't care. It's not that it's bad. It's just I really didn't care. I just wanted to get to the action.
And if I'm going to be critical of the game, even though like it has story, like if you're going to say, "Oh, critique this game," even the story, me not really remembering the story, wouldn't be like, I guess, a downfall for me for this, if it makes sense. It's not, I guess, I would hear like for other games where people, where the story is very important to the game. To me, that doesn't really matter so much with this game, and that's not a bad thing. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the story is just what it needs to be. As Kevin sort of said, the Doom Marine is like, demons bad, I kill them. And like, that's what I do too. I know there's a story about, you know, the UAC and opening portals to hell. And then you have to stop the woman whose name I forget.
Olivia.
Olivia, and Samuel Hayden is helping you stop Olivia. And she, I guess she just wants more power. I don't know what her intention is other than just more power. So you do that. And then eventually... This is a spoiler cast, right?
Yes. Yeah, we're good.
Samuel Hayden is also bad. So yeah. that was all I really needed to get from the story.
That's totally fair.
But is there something else you took away from it, Musty?
I mean, I think understanding some of the like backstory, which you sort of get through, you know, the audio logs or from Hayden himself, like he kind of goes into it a bit, but like, you know, the whole reason they're doing this is because there's the energy crisis, and they figured out a way to sort of crack a little bit of a hole into hell to kind of siphon this stuff out. And then Olivia, as I understand, was just a normal scientist. Something horrific happened, and so she like got this like degenerative like bone cancer or something. And so she's got that kind of like suit on that's cybernetic, that's actually allowing her to like function. And so as I understand, she made some deal with some demon lord that we don't ever come across, where she gave them a bunch, like all the cybernetics that they have are that she provided to the, to that side. And then what she did then was release what had been confined. So Hayden, who, as you said, Pam, you know, his motives aren't exactly all shiny either. He is doing research on these demons. He's done expeditions. That's where they found the sarcophagus and brought everybody back. And they've been working to, like, I don't know if it's weaponizing the lower level demons, but, you know, that's what Olivia uses as kind of the linchpin for this whole thing. And so, I mean, I found it did a nice job filling those moments of quiet with something. If it was just fights over, levels over, new level, new fight, and there wasn't a chance to kind of take a moment. And, you know, there were some, the first time you go to hell, there's those, like, they're not altars, but they're almost like little, like, pedestals, and you know you interact with them somehow, and then you hear some demonic voice kind of giving more backstory of the Doomslayer and how it seems like there's documentation on Hell's side of how much they fear this guy, which just makes you, you know, it's like, I'm a big deal. And I don't know. I found that all flowed very nicely for me. Could I have done without it? Sure. Why not? I did find some moments funny, and I know, Pam, one of your favorite moments from the game, I think, is, that you've noted here, involves exactly that, where he's just kind of done with it. You want to talk about the elevator at the beginning?
I think that moment was slightly different. Like, it's not the one with the, like, he doesn't want to listen, but, like, just at the beginning of the first level, he's like, he finds the shotgun on a dead guy, and then he sort of goes, he kills his first imp that sort of comes and screams at you, and you get on an elevator, and, like, the music's going, and it's got this, like, awesome heavy metal in the background, and then just, like, as he's, I don't remember if he's getting on the elevator or getting off the elevator, he, like, cocks his shotgun in time with the music, and it's just like, oh yeah.
is that as the doors open to the outside?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
They did a lot of really good mixing of music and action in general. I feel like now is a really good time to talk about McGordon. So why don't we do that? Who wants to talk about the music first, or maybe your favorite moments, or did you love it, hate it?
I'll go.
Okay, Ryan. Go, Ryan.
So I love if I gotta say a favorite track, it probably is the loading up the main menu track, which I believe is called Hellwalker. And I absolutely love it because it gets me, like, fired up. Even though it's like a kind of a long loading screen, it's still kind of playing in the background loading up to it. And I just love that, just the drums, and just, it's just like doo-doo. Dude. I'm gonna see if I can match that up with the beat here, but it gets me fired up for playing this game. Basically, it's just that really heavy metal. This is almost, the entire soundtrack is heavy metal or atmospheric music, if you will.
Yeah, that track has that little ting to mm-hmm. it that I don't know what they use to make that sound. Like, I almost, to me, that almost sounds like a bullet cartridge, like, dropping to the floor.
Yeah, there's something like that, or I know what you're talking about right at the beginning.
Yeah, it
kicks into the beat. It's, I don't know. It gets me fired up to play it every time. So it's something I always look forward to when loading up this game, is hearing just that intro theme.
You poor console players with your long loading screens. I feel bad for you.
Whatever. It's a living.
I like the music overall. I didn't have a favorite track. I just thought overall it was a good heavy metal track or soundtrack. I liked it when the music kicked in, you knew it was time to kick ass, and then when it would disappear, you knew that all the enemies were gone and it was time to move on and try to find the key or the button or whatever next. So I thought it was very effective.
Yeah, I think there was nothing more that I enjoyed than seeing weapon point unlocked, checkpoint, and then the music change, right? Like, it's just like...
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Time to breathe.
Yeah, for me, I really liked the BFG Division is the track name. It is the song that they... It's the song that they played at the Game Awards, and it's the one that kind of pulled me in. And then the moment that it comes up, it's got that like high sort of shrill melody to it, which I won't try to reenact for all of your ears purposes. But I really like that one. I found, so Bethesda has the entire OST on a YouTube video, and it is regularly on my like background music at work, and I like, it doesn't make me hostile, which is good, but it keeps me like, it's very motivated and driving, and the beat to it, I think is really cool. The other comment I was going to make, and then I don't want to forget to let Pam, I want to give you a chance to talk about the music. The there's a difference between the Hell music and the Mars music, in that there's like more choral stuff happening with the stuff that takes place in Hell. Like there's a lot more voices, whereas the Mars stuff is a lot more metallic and sort of robotic. Just a, I guess, an observation there from me. I don't know if you guys agree or not, but
yeah, I agree about that. There's definitely a bit of a different atmosphere to both of those places. I really like the soundtrack, which is kind of surprising. I'm not the biggest heavy metal fan in the world, although usually what ruins it for me is vocals, and so this being basically lacking vocals is probably what makes me like it so much. I actually got the vinyl of the soundtrack a couple weeks ago, and I think Rip and Tear is probably my favorite of the songs. And I agree with what you said before. Like, it's just everything is so well, like the sound editing is so good. Like this, how it ramps up when there's enemies and then it sort of slows back down when they're gone. Just like all the sound cues are really great.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. Well,
did any of you guys collect the little marine dolls that you can find around there?
Whenever I could find them. I mean, it's cool. You know, you hear the little vintage Doom music playing too. He touches the arm and then just puts them away.
When you find it, you get the little. Yeah.
Is there a reward for finding them all? Or I just know I can only find a few of them in the game.
I don't know what you get for finding that. But if you find. This was the Bug Doctor on Twitter who gave me this heads up. If you find all the classic levels in the game, which there's
levers that you can find that will open up a door somewhere else on the level. And if you go through it, you're playing a level from the original Doom or from Doom 2 or Final Doom. And it'll be like either part of the level or the entire thing. And if you find all of those, every level has one. If you find them all in the menu, you can play through the entire, like all the levels all at once.
All the retro ones?
Yeah, all the retro ones, yeah.
Nice.
It's kind of cool. And it's kind of like how they did it in Wolfenstein. You know, it's like you have your modern HUD and modern enemies, but it's just all the backgrounds and everything. The level design, everything is all retro style. It's very cool. See,
I didn't come across a single one of those retro ones. I did find some of the plushes. Which were I didn't get the fist bump. That was the one that I was like, because he did something a little bit different with each of them that I found. I never got the one where he fist bumped into the
like, yeah, yeah. They're random animations, I believe. Okay. So you just didn't luck out.
I just didn't find I didn't roll the dice right.
The first time I played it, I didn't find any of those rooms either. I didn't even know they existed until I started playing this round, and there was you know, just that orange colored secret that I had to find. I'm like, where is this thing? And then I found the lever and found my way in, and I'm like, I didn't even know this was in this game.
Yeah, those are especially hard to find. I find even sometimes if you manage to find the lever, the door isn't necessarily within like looking distance.
Yeah it could be in another completely different spot.
Yeah.
The door itself has a certain look, so once you find it, you know that that's where the door is, but you have to find it, and it doesn't always give you the marker. I can't remember if it gives you the marker where the door is or where the lever is, or I don't know. They're not easy to find.
I wonder if one of the perks, I believe, for the suit is it makes it easier to find like hidden items in the game, but
yeah, it'll show up on the on the compass.
Doesn't it also the controller vibrates as you get close to a secret? Is that an upgrade? Yeah.
Yeah. I did. If you're using a controller.
Yeah. Does it do anything for you if you're on messing keyboard now?
Be nice.
Keyboard just shakes. That'd be nice. Yeah. So I mean, there was a lot to collect. You briefly brought up weapon enhancements. I feel like we've talked weapons to death at this point, but. There's the Argent upgrades.
Can I talk about my favorite weapon?
Yes, I'm sorry.
No one mentions it. Just, I'm surprised it's not more popular, but the plasma rifle is my favorite. The plasma rifle with the heat blast. Mm-hmm. I just find it so, like, it's not the strongest weapon, but if you've got a whole bunch of, like, imps or possessed or whatever around you, you hit that heat blast and you just don't have to worry about them anymore. And then also the shot.
Does it take them all the way out, or does it just stagger?
Yeah, it'll take the weak guys all the way out if it's fully charged. Yeah.
I don't even think I got. I found myself being very selective about my customizations, and I think I may have skipped that one altogether. I can't remember what the other option is for it.
I think it's a stun of some kind.
I think that's what I did, and I didn't bother using that. I unlocked it, but I didn't bother using it. I did the assault rifle a lot because I liked the once you master the upgrade on that with the rockets.
Mm-hmm.
Those mini rockets are they chew things up big time, and eventually you get to the point where every piece of ammo can just be a rocket.
Yeah,
just like
I like anything. Anything with explosions, also the regular shotgun with the explosive shot. Anything where I don't have to be particularly good at aiming is good for me.
Yeah, those little missiles will, I'm not sure if that's an upgrade or not, but they hone in on the enemies too, which is pretty nice. So if you just miss it, it'll just whip around the corner and take them out.
Yeah, against single enemies, especially like bosses, I found that was like, I did not mind unloading 200 missiles into that guy.
Yeah.
So there were some upgrades to the, you know, yourself. You could boost health, you could boost armor, and then boost your ammo capacity. And those were just kind of randomly found on dead soldiers. Did you guys, given the choice between the three, like which ones did you have one that you went after first as far as like maxing out, or did you max them out?
Yeah, I went for health and then health, then ammo, then armor. Like I maxed out, made sure I had my full health and made sure I had full like ammo first. I found armor because I don't remember getting like refills from killing enemies from the armor, and I could be wrong in this one. I only remember finding like the little green clips on the ground, or the big shield, or the one that looks like a football shoulder pads, if you will. You know, like I found those, you know, less than I did the ammo. And I felt like I always wanted to make sure I didn't run out of ammo for these guns that I liked using, and I wanted to be at full health. So I made sure I went after those first. I believe I maxed it out completely. But if I missed it this time, it would have been just the armor if I did. But that's all I can recall.
Yeah, I've got the same sort of priority in terms of stats, but they all ended up maxed out by the end.
I was the same too.
I went with offense is the best defense. So I just went with anything that gave me the best, like that sort of advantage, rather than health or armor upgrades. I always just went with like the best, you know, what's going to give me the edge in the offensive zone.
Yeah, for sure.
But that's because I'm so good at games.
Right. Somebody's got to take the mantle.
I don't get hit. Getting hits for posers.
Right. Did you know that there's a little noise that happens when you're low on health?
Who knew?
Talked about the enemies. We talked about like enhancements and things like that. We really didn't talk too much about, we named the bosses, but we didn't really talk about the boss encounters. Do you want to talk about maybe ones that you enjoyed, or maybe ones like that one with the guardians in the little circular arena that I despised? I was not a fan of that one. Partially because that fight can be so long. And the moment that, you know, like if you don't take that one guy out, so the guy in the middle has a shield, and then he's got multiple different fire attacks. He can throw this thing around the ring of the circle, and it kind of, it's about getting that pattern down. Once you figure out the pattern on that, then you got to make sure you get the next one. There's one attack where he does these like fire, they're just like spikes of fire that come out to the edge. And I found myself being to the side of them and still dying, like just misted. And I didn't understand why. So it's like, I go,
did you fire a rocket at him when he was doing that, building up that wall before it's coming at you? Like when you can see it like coming up, and if you fire a rocket, it will stun him completely. And then
really?
You
can go up.
Yeah.
Well,
Believe me, Musty, I know what you're talking about, because I remember on my first playthrough, that I think that was like the hardest boss for me completely, mm-hmm. where it took me like over a day. Like I got so frustrated, I had to stop and I couldn't figure it out. And then after that, he spawns into two, right?
Yep. But they don't have shields, so you can just lay into him constantly. But you have to balance. You got the guy who's got more projectile attacks, and then you got the guy who's coming after you. And so you got to figure out, like, you know, you got to prioritize.
They have a charging attack, right, where they have to charge up before they unleash their attack, and that gives you that small window opportunity to, if you get them when they're trying to charge up, it stuns them both, I believe, if not just at least the one, and that gives you the full advantage. That part of the battle, that was for the first playthrough for me, that was the hardest part of this whole game. On this playthrough, I don't mean to change the subject for you, because I know you're.
No, I was gonna hand off to someone else to talk about a different bosses, but go for it.
I think of Dean, if you're still watching here, he was watching me in the stream when I was trying to figure out the final boss, which is the Spider Mastermind. That was on this playthrough, like I couldn't figure out what I did on my first playthrough, and then I just kept getting destroyed and destroyed by the Spider Mastermind, which is officially, was it? It's Olivia.
It is Olivia.
She becomes this final boss. But if it wasn't for what's it called, like the like my what I finally figured out to beat it was you just have to stay far away and shoot from a distance. Just don't let it get near you and just keep shooting. And eventually, it's incredibly easy if you do that. But if you ever try to get anywhere near this boss, you will get destroyed. But yeah, it's, you know, there's that level of difficulty, and it's like you said, it's trial and error, where, you know, until you figure out what it is that, you know, that one spot you have opportunity to take out a boss. Yeah, that's, I don't know, that's a good one.
Yeah, there was one thing about this game I found that was interesting is that it really kind of, that old statement of like doing the same thing, like the definition of insanity is doing the same thing and expecting a different result. You really needed to adapt your approach, because if all you did was follow the same line and take out the same enemies in the same pattern, then you were bound to continue to fail. There's a spot with the train where you ride the train into sort of what's like a train depot before you go after Vegas Core. And that one, that was my toughest stretch, because you've got all the enemy types. You've got a section of the ground that's electrified. And so if you fall in, you have to jump out amongst, a swarm of enemies. There's those screaming guys, the screaming heads. Blood Souls, maybe, I think might be the name. I can't recall. Those guys, like, hated those moments. Every time I heard the scream, I'm just like, where? And it was usually behind me, and I'm just like, just taking damage where I shouldn't be. But yeah, I needed to, the first time it's like, okay, well, let's take out these guys first. And then just keep trying. And eventually you work your way through it. But, there were a couple other pretty cool bosses. Pam, I know you like the, Cyber Demon.
I love the Cyber Demon. I it's funny because I couldn't explain the first phase of the fight to you, because you face him not long after getting the BFG. And so the first time I saw him, I just emptied the BFG into him. And I was like, oh, he's dead. That was easy. And then it like takes you to hell for the second phase of the fight. And I'm like, oh, shoot. But that second phase is so fun, like so much like strafing and jumping and dodging. It almost made me think of like World of Warcraft boss fights where that require a lot of movement and things. And it was really fun. It took me a lot of attempts to kill it the first time I saw him, but that was one of sort of the most fun moments and one of the most memorable moments in gaming for me for the last few years. That's where I would use the grenades, the like health draining grenades. So I would just like toss one at him and get a little bit of health back as I was dodging his attacks. So yeah, that was a really, really fun fight. Though I did feel like the boss fights kind of tapered off after that. Like I thought that was such a good one, and then the other two didn't quite live up to it.
Well, yeah, there was almost a rhythm game kind of built in with the waves of energy down the corridors. Yeah. I like that one too. You made a good choice for sure. Kevin, did you have a boss? I don't want to miss out asking you if you had a favorite.
No, iterate what Pam had said. Cyber Demon was definitely my favorite. I like how he got that was like a pipe or something. You throw it up in the air, and then all of a sudden you're in hell, and you're fighting him all over again. Yeah, it was good. Enjoyed that one.
Yeah, definitely. You guys play the multiplayer at all?
No.
Aside from the beta,
I downloaded the demo and I played one round. And I said this isn't for me. That's all I touched. I probably should go back to it. It's probably been updated like 20 times over. And I have been enjoying the Quake Champions multiplayer. So, you know, maybe I would if I do go back to it, but couldn't really say if it's good either way.
Yeah, I totally skipped on it too.
Did anyone try out the VR mode of the game? There's a VR.
I started it on place. Well, I think it's on everything, but I have it on PSVR, and I it's as a VR game, it is different than stuff that I would want to play. Like, I played Farpoint, which allows for full movement, and then, you know, you just use the head tracking to kind of direct where you're going. This, a lot of the movement is point at an area, zip to the area. Now, they conveniently, if you stagger a demon, you can then point at the demon, and then the glory kill is you zipping over and then just obliterating that demon. But I didn't get too far into it. It is a side story that actually starts off in the Lazarus facility as another soldier. It's interesting, though. I mean, it's the same level of quality as far as visually, but I think if you it'd be one of those where I wouldn't put somebody who's a VR novice in front of that game. I think it might be too much. And then again, you've got imps charging up and like right in your face, which is a lot to handle in VR. So
you can't be continuously moving. Then you can just move.
There are controls. There are controls to get you there, where you can still move, but the most effective means is to do the sort of zip to teleport. Yeah. I think is really a better term for it. But yeah, to kind of teleport, like zip. And so if you can't deal with motion, that type of motion, it's probably not going to be your cup of tea. I hear it's short, maybe 5 or 6 hours at the most, but that's longer than I played with Farpoint. And by the end of that time with Farpoint, I was kind of done. I was happy with the game, but this is not a Farpoint podcast, so what am I talking about? I would like to get back to it sometime, but I feel like that's one, again, that's probably best for me in chunks, but a lot of the mechanics are still there. It's just you're not the same guy, but you still do a lot of the same things. That's about all I got for you on that one.
Fair enough. What did you guys think of the platforming in this game? I thought it was very weird to see in a Doom game, because it was more of something that you'd find in a Half-Life game or in Metroid Prime, mm-hmm. but to have platforming in this, I don't know. It's just, I generally don't like platforming in first person perspective, and this one didn't change my opinion at all.
I wasn't thrilled about it at first. I also don't like first person platforming, but I did find it very, very forgiving. Like, I felt as long as you pointed yourself basically in the right direction, you would make the jump that you were trying to do. So I didn't have too much problem with it. There were a couple sections, like I think the Argent Tower was the level mm-hmm. where you had to like do a lot of climbing, where it, you know, felt like a little much, especially if you ever fell down and then you had to climb all the way back up. But I was surprised with how much I didn't hate it.
I like the markers, the green markers for like here's the way that you should go, and that was more than just on the platforms, right? Like there were some areas where it was just like there's a green light, you're probably going in the right direction. I think at least they did a good job of fitting the little bit of hand holding through those sections with something that was in the universe, right? It's not pigeon stuff in Tomb Raider or that kind of thing, but at least you knew you were going in the right way. I liked it. I liked it more once the double jump was in play. Like that was a lot of fun. There's some jumps where it's just like, I don't think this is the right thing to do, but I'm gonna do it. There's one toward the end where you're just jumping off a cliff, and you have to kind of gauge, like, if you just land, you're fine. For some reason, your suit compensates for the fall, so you don't take fall damage, but it slows you down. So if you can conveniently time your double jump to make that happen closer to the ground, you can just kind of hit the ground running a lot easier.
It is just because on this playthrough, I'm trying to find all the hidden stuff. And there's a lot of platforming that's like a lot of things are hidden because you need to platform your way to it. So maybe that's why it just stuck out to me this time around.
I could see that.
Yeah, that's true. The one place I did find it difficult is that there is a rune challenge that is a sort of mobility challenge where you have to go through this place and there's sort of two walkways on either side and then just like the void in the middle, and you have to get all these runes, and it involves like double jumping and like double jumping while strafing. And that was probably the challenge I had the most trouble with and had to do the most amount of times to finally get it.
Yeah, I was kind of surprised with those rune trials, how restricted they are. There's only really one way to get through them. And it's surprising because the rest of the game, like I was using, like you guys were using different weapons. I was using the shotgun. It's very forgiving. You can find different ways to mix things up and take enemies out. It's all how you prefer to play it. But those rune trials are, there's only one way to get through it and you got to figure it out. Which I don't know. I've found that kind of jarring compared to the rest of the game.
From the regular part of the game, I skipped the ruins. I found the platforming to be pretty good. So I don't know. That's the only thing I'd say. I didn't do the ruins, so I guess maybe the platforming wasn't so much a challenge for me.
But, spoken like a true N64 fan, doesn't mind 3D platforming at all.
Nope. Perfect. Perfect, yeah. 3D platforming. But no, it felt good with the double jump. I guess I don't know. It was pretty good. You know, I used it a lot in battle to get around from between floors, and I used it to my advantage. But I didn't really use it to solve puzzles, if that was the case, you know. But
yeah, I think I had played through Halo 5 prior to this, and Halo 5 had some of that same kind of mantling to get to higher levels. So I think I was a little bit used to that. This was easier because you didn't actually have to press a button to make it happen. Which was nice. It was like you said, if you're close enough, it'll let you do it. And later on, there's an upgrade then to speed that process up so that you mantle faster, which just keeps that flow going, which we all like. We all like that flow. So,
did anyone try Snap Map?
No.
I did the tutorial just because I wanted the achievement. But that was the extent of my Snap Map.
I like those things for people that, you know, it's there for people that want it, but I don't want to build my own game. I want to play other people's games.
I feel exactly the same.
I think I would have been more motivated if I had been into the multiplayer, but again, I'm bringing up Halo. Forge was something that I would mess around in, but it was more for fun. I don't know that, you know, Doom as a multiplayer suite isn't one that's like a, let's just have a casual, you know, jumping around, or let's pretend to play golf or something. That just wasn't happening in this game.
I'm sure there's a lot of people that have done great things with it, especially considering, I mean, you have all those Doom games to draw inspiration from, and probably all the Quake, like people probably have built, you know, exact replica of old levels in this game to replay in this modern way, and it's probably great, but who has the time for all that?
That's right. They don't pay us enough for that.
I guess I'll save it for my final comments.
Well then, Kevin, let's have you hit lasting impressions, overall rating, and your kind of final thoughts. Tie a bow on this thing.
Okay, well, I think this is a great game that everyone should play, even if you're not a fan of first-person shooters. It does enough different to make it stand out from the rest, so there might be something there for you. It mixes in well. I like to think of this game as the Mario Galaxy of the Doom series, where Mario Galaxy kind of took bits and pieces from the previous games and put them all into one nice package and added its own spin to it. And I think that's what Doom has done well. It's not only taken stuff from the Doom series, but it's also taken stuff from id's other catalog, like Wolfenstein and Quake, like all the enemies falling apart when you attack them, that's a leftover from Quake, and they put that into this game. So it's kind of cool to see that. I give this a huge recommendation and think everybody should at least try it. It's good times.
Pam, let's hear your lasting thoughts, and then we'll go me and then Ryan.
Yeah, I feel pretty similarly, except for the Mario Galaxy thing, because I don't know that game. But I think it's a fantastic game. It's sort of like a breath of fresh air in terms of the shooter genre. I really hope that other shooters going forward kind of take a page from this, and shooters become more about the movement and the aggression rather than like the hiding and the recovering health. If they would swing back that way, that would be a pretty cool thing that I think Doom could set the trend on. It was great to replay it again. It's probably one of those games that I would go back to every couple years to give it a replay. Unless Infinity ends up being superior, then I would probably go back to that one instead.
Excellent. All right. Let me say that I mentioned this earlier. I regret not having persevered to play this game through when it originally came out, and so I thankfully I didn't miss the bus entirely on it. I got back to it, you know, in 2016. But you have to be. I will say, for those who maybe don't play a lot of first person shooters, or people who maybe aren't as keen on the kind of concept, if you're not feeling it, that's okay, but give it another try. There's a point, and I it's different for a lot of people, but I know a lot of people have said that, you know, at some point, maybe two levels in, three levels in, things click, especially once you figure out the flow and the speed and the dance, the Doom dance, that is, you know, weapon switching and all of that. And this game does that so masterfully that I cannot wait to see what happens with the next in the series. It looks like they're amping up that moving around to a whole nother level. And I'm very happy that a studio like Bethesda, who is pushing a lot of these single player first games, has this one, and I'm really happy with what they have done. I would recommend it to just about anyone. I know that some people maybe don't deal with motion well, and so that's, if you have physical reasons why you can't, then I understand, but I have no reason to not recommend this to everybody who has the means to play it. And it's on every major console and PC, so you've got a reason to play it if you have a system. So highest recommendation from me, for sure. Ryan.
Yeah, for me, I recommend it to almost about anybody, unless you are a person who needs to have story, like a deep, in-depth story. This game might not be for you, but for me, it's fantastic. I recommend it to everybody. It's cheap now from everywhere I looked, unless maybe you are buying the Switch version, but everywhere else, it's pretty cheap, and it's a lot of fun. I loved everything about it. For you know, I'm kind of over playing the online multiplayer games at the moment. But I do love first person shooters. So this hits that sweet spot for me. And it plays great on a console. So I recommend it for almost about anybody. And with that being said, we'll get into the CC three word reviews. So to start us off for the CC three-word reviews, we have Diego with Glory Killing Goodness.
That's a good one.
Yep, that's a good one.
We miss you, Diego. Come back to Twitter.
No, that's right. That's
fine. Don't come back to Twitter.
Yeah, you're probably...
We have East Gilliam at East Gilliam. He has that soundtrack, though. Jacob Shaw wrote Rip and Tear, and I probably should write down almost everyone here who wrote Rip and Tear, because there's a few here. We have Raiho at Raiho the Magnifico. Thank you.
Raiho, you should change it to the Magnifico now. The Magnifico.
It's so much easier to say. he wrote Go to Hell. Church at the Game Grinder wrote Rip and Tear. Josh at Frantic Society wrote Oh Hell Yeah.
Nice.
Mighty Q Dog wrote Glorious Killing Shooter. Flock of Nerds wrote Sick Guitar Riffs. Chris R. the bass guy wrote Bloody Fun Shooter. Jeffrey Hillary wrote.
I see what he did there. That's good.
I did too. Now it went over my head. That's right.
Oh, I just got it. Very, yeah. Very nice.
Jeffrey Hilliard at Self Destructo wrote Guns and Guts. The Nostalgist wrote Effin' Bloodbath. I censored it here for children. Round 2 Gaming wrote Barrels of Fun.
There's no barrels in this game.
He's got a picture of the double barrel shotgun, the super shotgun.
Oh, double barrel shotgun.
Explosive barrels.
There are some explosives.
Oh, yeah, I guess so. Okay.
Mrs. Q-Dog wrote Intense and Scary. Deej 13 wrote Still Fun Online.
I think you may have been the only one.
That's true. Tony Brazzle at the Brazzle Spective wrote Brutally, hellishly excellent. Jake at the McAxel wrote Mick Gore Done. Travis Play Games wrote Gory Glory Yum Yum.
I've got to question a lot of people's opinions on bloody video games now.
Yeah. Excalibur wrote Fast, Frantic, Ferocious. Keen at Keen MMA wrote Rip and Tear.
So I have to ask, what is this? Is this a positive review? All the rip and tears.
I'm not sure if it. Many of these are reviews, so fair much enough. As words that describe the game.
So I was thinking it's one of them actually may have accidentally typed "rest in peace" and "tear," but maybe that's what. It's probably not it.
Chris Gerardo wrote Full Metal Mayhem. Did you want me to skip Scott Game of Silence One Musty?
I don't even remember what it was.
What did he say?
Fap, fap, fap.
There you go.
That's fine.
That's fine. Okay.
I didn't want to say it.
Sergio Martinez wrote First Person Ripper. Vidya Gamer wrote Shoot, Punch, Repeat. Cartridge Bros P1 wrote Sweet Killing Tunes. That's it from the community, so let's hear it from the panel. Kevin, what is your three-word review?
My three-word review is Barrels of Fun.
There you go.
No, it's not. It's No Loading. Nice. Forgot to mention
Pam, what's your three-word review?
There's no reloading in this game.
Hmm. Yeah, that's another good thing that keeps the speed up. My censored three-word review is badass freaking game.
There you go. Musty, what's your three-word review?
It doesn't disappoint.
And mine is fast, fantastic, fun. Right.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. I didn't think of anything Doom Hell related. Hellishly good time. There you go.
You should have went with Barrels of Fun.
Barrels of Rip and Tear. Rip and Tear, it's a real good one.
Think of any games you could use Barrels of Fun with. Isn't that what Bonus Barrel's all about?
I think there's a whole forum post about it, yeah.
Yeah. Barrels of Fun.
And that's the show, everybody. So with that being said, I want to thank our panel for being here. And I'm going to start off with Kevin. Where can we find you online?
Well, let me just say thank you guys so much for having me on. And I think you guys are doing a good job taking over from the bros. And I look forward to listening to where this show goes in the future. And if you want to find me, just type in Retro Fandango into any browser. And my podcast that I do with Richard, a.k.a. The Rambox, will pop up and you can listen to me there.
Pam, where can we find you?
You can find me on Twitter @Jasyla_, that's JASYLA_, or you can find me on YouTube where my channel is called Cannot Be Tamed, or you can find my podcast Media Mavens wherever you listen to podcasts, though we are on a bit of a hiatus right now as my co-host has just moved to South Korea.
Well, thank you for being here today.
We hope you guys come back.
Me too.
For me, you can find me on Twitter at ItsRocketSauce, and I'm occasionally on, or mostly on, Tuesday's CC Hangouts. So if you want to come on and chat, it's open to almost anybody, you know. So just shoot, you know, private reply to the Hangouts Twitter and come and join us. Musty, where can we find you?
Yeah, so you can find me on YouTube at Second Breakfast. That's the channel name. On Twitter at MustyHobbit. And again, I'm also usually at the Hangout if you are inclined to be there. But yeah, again, thank you to the panel. Thank you, Ryan. Again, season six is underway, and we are really looking forward to the coming months ahead and this whole year. We have a rough idea of what it is that we want to do throughout the calendar year, or throughout the rest of this season, but we've got big things coming the next couple months. So I want to reiterate that for the month of October, we are playing Resident Evil 2, available on a whole lot of systems, and want to give people a chance to, again, get first impressions if they don't already have them before the remake comes out early next year. So looking forward to that one quite a bit. And in November, we're doing something that's unprecedented in that we are playing a brand new game, as in comes out the week before November, and we are playing Red Dead Redemption 2. If you're interested in playing along, please, you know, let us know. The forum posts will be up for those as their respective months begin, but we're very much looking forward to having a lot of people along for the ride on both of those. If you are interested in supporting the club or its contributors, I do want to encourage you to check out the Patreon. We do have patrons at the club backer level or higher do get access to these live recording sessions, where other levels also get access to the archived and edited video presentation. We're very much looking to supplement those things with fun perks for people. And so if that's your kind of thing, definitely check it out. The club itself runs solely on support from the community itself. So we want to thank all of you for that support. But that's going to do it for us here today. We do look forward to hearing from you next month and throughout the rest of the season. We're going to wrap things up by saying a good old CCU night.